upon a time, there was a beautiful princess who lived in a shining castle, who spent her days wishing on stars, flying with pixie dust, and never growing up. She had ladies to play with her, chauffeurs to drive her to balls, and birds to sing to her, and then she woke up. Because the lady was her mom, the chauffeur was her dad, the birds were crows picking at the neighborhood trash cans, and the princess was a 5-year-old waving a $10 plastic wand from Walmart. But that didn't stop her from dressing up as Cinderella until she realized there were no sizes for teenagers. Or from striding into her closet, determined to find Narnia, only to slip and bang her head on a shelf. So, after much testing, tears, and sleepless nights, I've come to a disappointing conclusion. I'm not Cinderella. But just imagine my excitement when I found out I was named after Cassandra, a Greek princess. And just imagine my disappointment when I found out I was named after Cassandra, a Greek princess who gets tossed off a wall during the Trojan War. Frankly, I hate telling you this, so I'm just gonna get it out there. The truth is no fairy tale. Actually, it's genuinely awful, which is probably why Disney skipped the part in the original Cinderella where the stepsisters cut off their toes. But I'm on a quest. A quest to prove that the truth can do something besides crush innocent souls and dreams. To prove that it's not only important, but necessary. So, I've rounded up 4 truths, and we're gonna plug our noses and face down these dragons together, starting with truth number 1. Softball is not my sport. I lasted about 5 minutes in the public school system, but while I was there, I signed up to play softball. Took a couple of games for me to get hit by the ball. A couple of games later, I was a tennis player. But before I left the team, my wonderful parents tried to assuage my fears of getting hit by the ball with a plan I've titled the Michelin Initiative. They took me to Sports Authority, bought football pads big enough for a horse, strapped them to my shoulders, and plopped me on home plate. Have you ever seen that commercial for Michelin tires with the lumpy, rubbery mascot? Yep, that was me in the football pads. Needless to say, we had a conversation that night about the social benefits of tennis. But you know what? I'm blessed to have the parents I do. I know this girl, and even though she's an amazing person, she can't sing at all. Somebody should tell her, but no one does. Not one person in the entire stadium when she belts the national anthem completely off pitch. To quote a Disney movie, when everyone's super, no one will be. We have to be able to tell someone when they aren't Whitney Houston. Because you know what happened after we had another talk after my failed tennis season? I picked up a pen and wrote a novel. And after my ballet instructor told my mom I had about as much flexibility as a brick, I picked up a guitar. But not only do we have to know when we're really, really not good at something, we also have to know when something isn't what people say it is. Which brings us to truth number 2. Ketchup is not art. My family and I recently visited the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. After passing through galleries filled with works by masters like Henri Matisse, we found it. It was a chair hung from the ceiling. It was called the chair. The critics raved over the vision, the depth, the metaphor. Maybe I should have hung up our dining room set. But where's the ketchup in all this? Well, I recently read about another piece of modern art in a Right News article. It was apparently a desperate struggle to name the piece, but after months of inner turmoil, the artist aptly called it Untitled. The critics described the contrast that echoed in the painting's euphoric loops and vermilion floods of paint that oozed and cascaded down the canvas. A reporter described it as
What would probably happen if a 2-year-old toddler was left on its own with a bottle of ketchup?
It sold for $50 million. I'm sorry, but ketchup is not art. It's a condiment. And some fiction these days, it's not literature. It's fire kindling. We all know it, don't we? And a note to some pop music artists, namely Justin Bieber. Stop. Please, stop. Maybe we can think about it like buying diamonds. With art, music, writing, and life in general, we can appreciate the real thing a whole lot more when we point out the knockoffs. So yeah, a chair is just a chair. But lately I've noticed how our culture contorts the truths that should be blatantly obvious. So we come to truth number 3. I am not Chinese. This should be evident by now. But what if I told you that I was Chinese? Are you gonna tell me I'm not? That I can't feel Chinese? Well, my brother recently showed me this video done by the Family Policy Institute of Washington. The director of the institute asked students at Washington University whether they would believe that he, a short white male, was a 6'5" Chinese woman. One of the students replied, "If you thoroughly debated me or explained why you felt that, I feel like I'd be very open to saying you were 6'5", or Chinese, or a woman." Bless his heart. Still, we're left with some questions. Why is it so hard to tell a white male that he's not a Chinese woman? And if we don't know the truth about who we are, if we can't answer the easy questions, how on earth are we ever gonna answer the hard ones? Look, if y'all felt called to think that my name today was the Empress of everything Disney, I would not be mad. But the truth is, identity is not the weather. It can't change every time a storm blows in. And even though I have an infinite appreciation for Chinese history and culture, I'm pretty sure I was descended from Mediterranean horse thieves. What can you do? Recently, our culture has been calling for tolerance, accepting people as they are, without judgment. But I think that's the missing link in our logic. Judgment is a good thing. Without it, you'd probably think that I was a good cook, an assumption that I promise would cause serious future pain. Our culture is sorely lacking the ability to call it like it is. So right here, right now, let's face the biggest, scariest truth of all. The darkness is real. We live in a culture of lies. Lies that corrupt, pervert, and destroy all goodness and light that no amount of pixie dust is gonna fix. We can never be what we wanna be. We can only be what we are. And we don't deserve to be saved. When optimists like me hear that, we wince and say, but it can't be that bad. But the truth is, if we can't face the reality, the darkness, the lies, we never get to see how truly and desperately we need the greatest truth of all, God and His love. When I started writing this speech, I wanted to know, is there some middle ground between unbridled tolerance and judgmental gavel-whacking? So I went and pulled out this really great book on truth. It's called the Bible. And Ephesians 4:15 tells us instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. Speak the truth in love. All day, every day, to everyone we know. Life may not be a Disney movie, but we can make it better. Each time we tell young girls that no, they don't live in castles, but they are princesses. Each time we tell young boys that yes, they can still be men, and gentle while they're at it. Each time we tell our aching world that yeah, it's dark outside, but the light is coming. The truth is hope. Hope that is real and necessary if we're going to become the people that God designed us to be. So, despite all evidence to the contrary, I'm not Cinderella. But it's okay. I've accepted that, because you know what? The truth is, there are 11 other princesses. Thank you so much for all of your time.